Rob Tippen wins his home race. Neowood has it. Neowood is champion. Linus and Thomas, champions in teams.
Sound hört. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the pre-season race of the Winter Challenge by RF2 Racing League, the GT3 Winter Challenge, of course. My name is Sebastian Gerd, and I won't be the only host for you tonight. I have someone else with me, Lucas. You are there tonight with me, and you will, I think, follow through the entire season. Welcome, Lucas.
Yeah, hello. I'm Lucas, and I try to do my best casting this stream with you, and I hope we have a lot of fun.
I hope so too. Lucas Schürmann, of course. Almost missed your last name. And where we are tonight, we are at Suzuka International Circuit, and what is there to expect? Two 30-minute races, so a pretty short racing on a pretty long track, actually. Suzuka, not the shortest one. Luckily, we don't have any rain tonight. It was raining in Suzuka on this noon, around 12:01 p.m. But now it's dry because we are collecting the real weather data of the track. So dry conditions for these drivers, and I think that's a very interesting field, very international. I haven't seen a field with so many drivers from so many countries in a while. I don't know, Lucas, how do you see it? Have you ever seen in sim racing 13 different countries?
Oh, 13. I counted like 9, but yeah, that's pretty much this. I never seen like this many before, and I think it's pretty cool that so many countries are involved in such a good event.
Yeah, I was a bit surprised, I have to say. RF2 Racing League, I knew that they have a bunch of international drivers, but just to name a few, we have Australia, then it's Great Britain, Netherlands, that's still kind of usual, Portuguese, Greece, from Poland, and there's one driver with us, from Spain, then but then there are also drivers from Madagascar or from South Africa, so that's very interesting. I think South Africa works because it's not far away from our time zone, actually, so It's only further down in the south, but not more to the west or east. That's the difference, because we are two other drivers. We have a driver from the USA, by the way, driving for the ACR Suckspeed team. So some pretty well-known drivers here as well. And Australia, well, I think it's pretty light and pretty early there at the moment, but obviously someone has the time to race from there. We just hope the ping is all right and no warping cars on the track.
Yeah. Is it Australia or is it Austria? I don't know. How's the short versions? Is AUS Austria or Australia? I'm confused.
Me too, actually, but I think the name made me think it's Australia, actually.
Ah, yeah, it's Australia.
Because Austria is AUT. We got the IOC codes of the countries, so that's maybe what caused a little bit of,
I was confused about this, so I had to look it up, and to regarding your saying of the time zone to our South African driver, it's now like 8 o'clock, and they are just 1 hour before us.
Yeah, so some afternoon or some evening racing like we have it here in Germany as well. Let's take a look at the current situation, because we are already in the qualifying. Very short event tonight, just the very short qualifying, only 10 minutes to go, and then we will have our 2 30-minute races. Stefan Dennecke, currently with the fastest lap time, the only one who broke the 2 minute limit, I would say. And then there's Christo Neuwied, who's in second, not far away from David Haas, just 0.3 of a second difference. Mike Leier, also not far behind, very close, followed by Christos Kaloudis. So, well, I think the first 9 drivers are pretty close together still, about 2 seconds. That's not that much, actually, on Suzuka. It happens, but then there are a bit huger gaps, and we're still waiting for Georg Waltz, Björn Wallmeier, and Markus van Wyk to set a lap time.
Ah, so Markus van Wyk has the 1 as his number. So I was confused that there is an I in the scoreboard, but it's a 1.
Yeah, he's the one with the first number, so to speak, driving for Kart World, and that's one of our South African drivers, by the way. Actually, very interesting, because we have 29 drivers currently on the list. I don't think everyone will be there tonight, because it's a preseason event, just checking still if there are some issues, some technical issues, or if we have some issues with the stream maybe. So that's all we want to figure out before the real season starts. That's the reason why maybe not so many drivers will be there tonight. Only 14 at the moment. So half of the field is there currently, but 13 countries, 29 drivers. That means if I took a look about how many German drivers there actually, and I think it's 5 or 6, if I'm not mistaken. So that's not...
It's 8.
It's 8. It's 8. Okay.
8 German drivers.
8 German drivers. So I haven't seen that in any other league so far, because I know the international series about, by the way, or let's say about Race from Racing Experience, if you know that simulation. I think a lot of R-Factor 2 drivers now roll their eyes, but they're also quite international, even if it's if there are bigger German events. But you find a lot of European drivers here normally, especially from further east, European. We have some drivers from Poland, there are a few from Hungary. That's nothing we see here. It's further down to the south and west. So it's a different situation here with R-Factor 2. And of course, we are very excited for this race evening. It looks like Stefan Denecke is improving his lap time more and more. 159.538 now, and almost a second quicker than Mike Lyra. He's also driving for Kartworld as well as Markus van Wyk. But Mike Lyra, one of the German drivers, well as Stefan Denecke for Laxative Racing going tonight.
Yeah, there are some pretty exotic names of the teams that I just heard today the first time. It's like Laxative Racing or race. I was like, okay, Laxative, that's somehow another thing than I thought of. I don't know. I saw the history of their name in the Discord, and I had to like smile upon this because they did it because they had like no other name, and there then they said, okay, let's do like Laxative Race. Yeah, and like Trollable, there are a few very cool names.
Yeah, I love it when there are different stories behind team names, and it's not just about let's take a name that fits racing, but just take something that's sounds funny or sounds interesting, where you want to know the reason behind the name. You know, that's a different if you have something like, I mean, I love that thing, Awesome Racing. That's the team around Rob Timpen and Christo Niewoot. And I think Niewoot was there on the server. Yes, he's he just dropped down to fifth position after the improvement of Costa Kaloudis. Costa Kaloudis was in second, and now it's Christo Niewoot just on time, and he's driving for Awesome Racing, and I love that mix in the name. Pretty cool. But then there's like Avenger Racing. That's, of course, sure, great name, but you won't actually ask after that team name. What's the reason behind that? And I think Laxative Racing, that's something different. It sounds like one of the drivers, when they were choosing the name, had some stomach troubles or something like that. But also like Lusitanium Sim Racing, it's also something very interesting. Team names where you're looking for a story behind it.
Yeah, I was confused about the Lusitanium, and then I googled it and I didn't find anything except for a startup company that helps startups get bigger, but I'm not sure if they are sponsoring them or if there's any connection between that. But it's a cool name.
Yeah, maybe we will find out about more about that. Just check the times. Georg Walz, Björn Wallmeier and Markus van Wyk still without any lap time, and I don't think they will have a chance to do it anymore. 3 minutes to go in this qualifying, so probably you have a chance to leave the pits now, and then you still have the opportunity to set one lap time, because after that, of course, when the time is over and you reach the start-finish line, the whole qualifying run for you is over. So Christo Niewoot would have two additional lap times to set, probably, but maybe he will enter the pits, I don't know. Now we can see the DeWolf Racing car. I think it was the Corvette. Maybe that was Georg Walz. It should be. Now in 13th position, 202.128. Here we are. Georg Walz for Netrace Motorsport. He's going, and I remember he was driving for Netrace so long, and always that black, yellow and blue design. And it's interesting to see how they improved it in the special style and design. It's been a while. Earlier it felt a bit off, but now in the past few years they figured out how to really put some beautiful designs on these cars, and I think that Corvette not only looks very good, it looks very distinctive with these colors. So you always, it always stands out, and I love that about team cars that have a design that's more about just some great stripes on the car, but it's just white, black, and red. That are those colors you see all the time. And then there's someone like this putting blue and yellow on one car, and that's I love that. Even if someone is driving a pink car, I would prefer a pink car way more than a black car, especially in sim racing, because you always see them. You see, oh, there's this driver with a pink car. And sometimes if you have a very strange color on your car, you become one of the loved cars by our viewers. Could happen. I remember that when people were saying like, I love that pink car. And then 3-4 guys as well saying, yeah, it's the same with me. And all the others that put some, maybe even as well, beautiful designs, but they are black and white on their car. They're just sitting there and thinking, oh, it did such a beautiful job, but no one realized it because it's always the same color.
Yeah, first thing that comes in my mind when you say like a pink car, it's the Porsche that has driven in Le Mans, that like pinkish and with all these names of the different parts of a pig on it. Yeah. It's some really it was remarkable. So if you remember this, then you were like watching Le Mans for like 10 seconds, because this car was so remarkable and outstanding in the complete race of the 24 hours of Le Mans, that you, if you think back, you just think of the pink car.
Yeah, you mean the pink pig? That's the truffle hunter, also called Büffeljäger. I also love that car. There are a few guys. I'm of course commentating some other sim racing series, and in the Porsche Cup, there were some guys that put that design on their 911 Cup Porsche, on the current version, and I love it. It's just beautiful, and it's a very beautiful homage on the Le Mans cars. But let's get back to the action on the track. It's probably Stefan Dänecke who will start from pole, already in the pits. But we have Christel Neuwood still going, who was up to second, but got pushed down the line by Rob Timpen. And now it's Björn Wallmaier. Björn Wallmaier haven't set a lap time for all the for the entire qualifying, and now he puts himself up to second, and Christel Neuwood now down into the third row of the grid. Then there's just Thomas Andriamiariosa. He's still going.
Andriamiariosa.
Yeah. you trained that a bit more than I did. Okay.
Yeah.
I see.
I had like 2 streams with him, and I perfected to say Andriamiariosa.
Okay. I see that. Georg Walz, the only one still going, so he might still have a chance to improve his lap time. Everyone else is in the pits, and that's his last chance. 2:1:2:8 for Georg Walz. Half a second behind Oskar Koenen.
Marius van Wyk never started, or?
No, he didn't start. Never set a lap, obviously. Well, we'll just start from behind the field, maybe collect some of the drivers that are in trouble, and then climb further up in the field. But now, how about Georg Walz? Will there be some improvement? He needs at least half a second to jump further up in the grid, and he doesn't. So it's Georg Walz in 13th. No changes there. Maybe something interesting for the event. The second race, the starting grid for the second race, 30 minutes. It is the same starting grid that results from this qualification run. So there's not like you find it in some other series, like the finishing top 10 from the first race was switched around, like a top 10 start reverse grid or something. No, when you set the pole here, you have the pole for both races. And that's something you don't see that often in sim racing.
Yeah, I was a bit into the organization and they thought of doing this, but they thought of it's easier to do first do this and then later maybe see if it worked out and maybe alter the rules in the next season. So just getting a progress done.
We switch to warm up, and well, if they want to the next season, that would mean we have to wait until next winter. of course, yeah. If you would, yeah, I know what you mean. Of course, I know what you mean.
Oh, the summer season.
Yeah, I get maybe the summer season. Well, we're looking forward to that when they probably start one. But let's focus on this winter challenge. And maybe who didn't follow RF Racing League so far, I can only think it's best just check Facebook, because there you can get all the new information. If there's a new season, if the next race or stream is coming, then you get the information there. But we will have our first real race for the Winter Challenge next week, Sunday, 25th of November. So put your mark on the calendar there for that race. And then it's a two-week... what would you say?
Two weeks scheduled.
Yeah, I think that's the proper name. So we will go on in December 9th, and then coming to then we have a small gap because of Christmas and everything, and we will start with the third challenge race in January 13th. So then we have to wait till then. So only two runs in 2018, so we get a glimpse maybe how the drivers are capable here in the GT3 series, in this GT3 Winter Challenge. I always tend to say series instead of challenge. Something that if you're commentating so much, these are names that just like hammered in your head and it's tough to get it out again.
Yeah. Get
you get that. I don't think you told me you're not so much in to commentating sim racing so far, but you are a lot of into motorsports, so I think that's great. And
yeah,
I
love motorsports, and I did streams of other games before. And then a friend of mine who's also doing sim racing, which is today not with us, Christoph Müller, he asked me if I would cast, and I did like two test streams, and now I'm here casting with you.
Yeah, and yeah, I think it just works out fine so far. I don't know what the chat is saying, and that's something I want to... as well. We are both, of course, checking the live chat here on YouTube, and if there are any questions about the GT3 Winter Challenge, about RF Racing League, or well, something else, or maybe criticizing our English, don't worry, we won't react to that. It's the best we can.
No, it's the best English you can get in the internet.
Right.
We're not bad in English, we're just trying to sound like Germans, but actually we're British.
I didn't want to tell them that. But okay, so now everyone knows. Okay, but of course you can do if you want to. But I hope there will be some discussion going on in the live chat. Of course, we will follow and react to that. But let's react to the results now from the qualification, just to give complete overview. So Stefan Dänecke will start from first in front of Björn Wahlmeier. Second row, Rob Timpen and Kostas Kaloudis. Then it's Christo Nevot in front of Mike Leier. From seventh, David Haas in front of Linus Lundwald. Thomas Andrea Miarisoa. I was close. I would say.
Yeah, you were close. You'll get close.
That. Yeah, I will get even closer next time. From ninth, from tenth position, Jürgen Wahlmeier. Then from the sixth row in the grid, it's David, and he just shortened his front name. So
Nick David.
Nick David. Don't know why I did that. Nick David. It's a pretty short name. I would understand it if Thomas Andrea Miarisoa would do that.
Andrea Miarisoa.
Close. Okay. So he's. I would understand if he was shortened down to T point. But Nick David from 11th. From 12th, we have Oskar Koenen. And then in the last row, seventh row of the grid, it's Georg Walz in front of Marius van Wyk, who didn't set a lap time for unknown reasons. But of course, it's the test race, it's the preseason event. So. No real fighting for positions, but rather testing, maybe still testing the car. I don't know, you were closer to the preparations of the or the organization of this whole event. So do you think there will be still some drivers that might change their minds about the car, or do you think they had enough training that they wouldn't switch to a different car because they said, well, I trained like 100 laps now on the Corvette, why should I switch to McLaren now in the last few days?
Yeah, I think like the teams I know are pretty well burned into their car, so they all drove like 100, 200 laps on Suzuka for their cars. And I don't think we will see any changes in cars, but there's still they could, because sometimes you get to know some things that don't work for your actual car or your setups. So I think we could see like one or two changes, but most of them will stay at their car. And because of other series or challenges where they drive the car as well, so they don't have to get used to anything new.
Of course, something that Georg Walz mentioned before the race, we were talking to him just briefly, and he said a lot of Corvettes there in this series, and if I'm not mistaken, we're talking about 12 Corvettes driven in this entire season. So that's almost half of the grid racing on that American really interesting car. And now we are waiting for the race start to come up. I'm curious and I'm excited how these guys will make it. Standing start, so we're just waiting for the green flag and then we are already off. So no rolling start or something, and still a few drivers in the pits. What do you have?
And they're gone.
And they're off. Just checking if someone is in the pits, and they're already off. And I still think Stefan Dänecke stays in front. Then Rob Timpen in second, and they're getting close together in the first corner. And there's already a crash, and it's Mike Leier crashing into David, if I'm not mistaken. And I don't know. You just put it in the. That's Nick David just sliding off the corner. But we need to go back to the live. What's going on in front? A bit too early in the replay, I think. So what's the top doing? Just 3/10 of a second for Rob Timpen behind Stefan Dänecke in the lead. He's chasing the McLaren drivers, followed by Björn Wahlmeier. But another Corvette, he dropped down to second. Nice move by Timpen there in front of before the first corner. And then they already have quite a gap, about 7/10 of a second ahead of Christo Neuwied. In the next Corvette, chased by Kostas Kaloudis. And then I think it's the first McLaren, or is it the Corvette of Magnus Lundwald. Oh, it's neither a Corvette or a McLaren, it's a Mercedes. So it's the Mercedes of Linus Lundwald. And Thomas Andriamiharisoa.
Yeah, that was pretty
That's
well.
He's behind his teammate. So they are in 6th and 7th, but it's close between Rob Timpen and Björn Wartmeier at the moment, and they Björn Wartmeier may be trying to fight back on to the 2nd position. Maybe we can switch there. And in front the slipstream from Rob Timpen, already showing on the inside line against Jeff van Denecke. Try to set an attack in the 130R, that's the name of the corner. Quickest corner on the entire track. Through the chicane, then down the straight finish, start finish straight, and Rob Timpen chasing Stefan Denecke. So Björn Wallmeier drops a
few
car lengths back.
We have one DNF now. We have Jürgen Wallmeier that is out. He was off track. I can switch to that. Ah, let's do.
It looks like he slid out of the track in the S's. Oh, and he crashed into the car with Georg Walz. So that's the first corner after in the second lap.
Oh.
And then, wow, heavy impact between both of them. And Walz just pushing the car of Jürgen Wallmeier in front of him. Maybe he tried to turn him around. Just slam the car slightly on the front and then that it turns around into the right direction, but that didn't work out. It ended up with DNF for Jürgen Wallmeier.
I think it wasn't... it was Marius van Wijk which was putting him there out there. The crash was between Jürgen Wallmeier and Marius van Wijk.
I think you're sure you're right because Marius van Wijk was down the order because he didn't set the lap time, and he was passed the two white Corvettes after that crash between Thomas Andri. Yeah, Miharisoa and Nick DeWitt.
Yes, and I think he was like he drove a bit to the right and then crashed into Jürgen, and then it was and then he got off track.
Yeah, it happens. Of course, pretty frustrating for Jürgen Wallmeier, the first proper race in the winter challenge, and then something like this, and Mike Lyra passing Georg Walz, who has some trouble in the chicane. Nice move by Lyra, sending Walz a bit off the track. He had to use the curb, and that's a bad idea in the chicane on Suzuka, because usually your car starts jumping
and
all over the place.
We have an off track. Okay.
Whoa, what's happening there? What's Oskar Koenen doing? Oh, the entire... then you saw like Thomas Andriamiharisoa, he was just blowing down, just opened the gap because he saw that Corvette behind him just flying.
That's
very strange. It's just like the rear wing broke off or something at the car from Oskar Koenen. Maybe this brake balance is completely wrong. Because I don't think there was a blown off tire or something, but Koenen, of course, now further down the order to 13th position. He was the one who had that early crash with Thomas Andriamiharisoa, and Nick DeWitt as well was sliding out of the corner. But we are back at the fight for the lead. Stefan Denecke still in front with the McLaren, showing all these Corvette drivers, what's possible with the British supercar? Because I expected when so many people are driving the Corvette that probably this car is maybe the fastest on the track, and it looks pretty fast. But then there's someone coming up with the McLaren, showing everyone, well, you see, you can go faster with a different car. But it's the same in other simulations with, for example, the Mercedes AMG. I know from racing experience, a lot of drivers using the Mercedes because it's the It lies on the track better than any other car, so you can make mistakes and this car is still going instead of sliding around. And that's very important when you're racing, when you are in sim racing. A lot of drivers that start with it, they always looking for, I wanted the fastest car, I can see the fastest lap times. But you tend to make mistakes sooner than later in a race. And then you hit the curb for some reason, or you don't hit the ideal racing line because someone is attacking you, and then you make a mistake, and then you need a car you can catch you, that.
Oh, we had a crash. We had Marius von Wyk going off track here. Ah, no, it was. Oh, I missed that. Took that.
Hey. Ah, yeah, that's the one we had. Track. And I still think that's pretty. Yeah.
I got confused. In the program we use.
Well, maybe you don't need to go for every off track. Maybe you just have to go for an off track where you realize that the lap times are suddenly dropping down very, very extremely. So if someone's losing like 5 or 6 seconds, then you might realize, okay, something must have happened. And then you see an off track, and then you can figure it out. Not every off track means a crash.
Yeah.
Or a spin. I remember handling that tool, and it happened to me as well. I see someone already spelling this entire the name of Thomas Andriami Harisoa in the chat. Just like, can this guy please read it again and read it again? I'm trying my best. Come on. I think I had it the last few times, and I'm really sorry for Thomas making a joke of it. Beautiful name, honestly, I have to say. I like it.
It's a bit complicated to get it in the right direction, but but it's a cool name.
Yeah.
I like it as well.
It sounds complicated, but I think if you have it once, then it works. But don't let's talk to so much about names, but about the action on the track. And they are staying really close during that race. It's impressive. Usually, especially in test races on a track like Suzuka, which is highly complicated. So they are still pretty close. So Rob Timpen only a second behind Dänicke. Then it's Björn Wallmeier who's closing the gap actually on Rob Timpen. Then Kostas Kaloulis, he's not so far away. Oh, careful there. That's a very, very dangerous turn on Suzuka. So in this, you have that first very quick right-hander, the Degner corner, and then you're slowing down in that 90 degrees right-hander crossing under that bridge. And usually if you go too wide there, you lose the grip on your rear tires and spin out, and then you heavily hit the wall on the right side. Seen that countless times, but Rob Timpen keeps the car straight out of the corner.
There's fights going on in the back there. Thomas Andriami so Andriami Andriami Harisoa is getting a bit further up the leaderboard.
Maybe we can check there past Marius van Wyk, but Marius van Wyk had that trouble, and I think Thomas is chasing Nick De Witt currently, half a second behind if I'm not mistaken, fighting for 10th position. And Andriami Harisoa in the slipstream of the Corvette of Nick De Witt. I don't think this will take much longer until we see the first move by Andriami Harisoa. Maybe on the start-finish straight. Nick De Witt driving for DW Racing. Driver from the Netherlands. He's currently alone in that team. Couldn't find a teammate so far. That's my last information I have about them. So maybe if there's still someone interested in the GT3 Winter Challenge of RF2 Racing League, there's still a chance to drive in the team with Nick De Witt, because currently he's alone. Doesn't say for Thomas Andre Yami Haisawa. He's racing for Seawolf Racing. And he's the only driver, and well, that sounds like they're usually a lot, but that's not. He's from Madagascar. So I love that. Only that fact is something I love. He's I don't know if he's currently in Madagascar, because I have to say that connection is working very well. I know drivers from very close to Germany, and they have a way worse connection than he has. So pretty good internet connection from Madagascar over here to Germany. And so it's easy for him to chase Nick DeWitt. And Nick DeWitt is closing in actually to Georg Walz. Walz from Netrace Motorsport.
And in the comments, they say that Nick DeWitt just overtook Thomas, and that's totally right, but Thomas overtook Marius van Wijk, so he's behind Nick DeWitt just now. Yeah.
Okay, so thanks for the information. They're seeing so well, and Thomas isn't leaving Nick DeWitt just go away with that, try to get that position back. And it sometimes looks strange because the colors on these two cars, on the AMG of Thomas Andreami Haisawa, is the same as on the Corvette of Georg Walz. And Georg Walz is racing for Netrace Motorsport, and Thomas Andreami Haisawa for Seawolf Racing. But usually they are a combined team. So usually you find them in other sim racing events as Seawolf Netrace. So that's why they the colors are the same, but different team names. So, but you don't try an attack in the S's usually in Suzuka, because there's only one proper racing line. If you miss that, you get very, very slow. You lose a lot of time. They're getting even closer to Georg Walz, and I'm not sure what Georg Walz is going to do. Maybe he tries to slow down Nick DeWitt a little bit for the chance to Thomas Andreami Haisawa. And there is a crash. And what happened there? That was Christo. You see, there is a that's Christo Niewoodt, who spun out and just spun into the racing line of Thomas Andreami Haisawa. And he was trying to avoid the crash with that Corvette, but just got hit slightly on the left side of the car and then just spinning out. And it looks like that car has some slight damage now. But the worst is you have some damage on your tires. And this will definitely won't help with the handling of that AMG. And now Nick DeWitt, no more need to watch into the mirrors. Now he can focus on Georg Walz chasing for 8th position. Further up the field, there's not much going on at the moment. They're all away from each other about 1 or 2 seconds. We can focus on this bike.
David
currently.
Haas had an off track, and now he's 14 seconds behind. I don't know if this wasn't was the crash or if he was behind that much the whole time.
I don't know either. Maybe you can find it, check it in the list, so while I stay with this battle here. Here we are. Oh, and he almost got it and then spun around. Air spoon corner, sometimes quite tricky if you go too wide in the first left-hander. The rear of your car tends to slide around. Well, good luck for Mike Lyra. Now he can try to grab 6th position from David Haas. Mike driving for the Kart World team. It's Nick DeWitt again against Georg Walz, and he's pushing it. Oh, what's Georg Walz doing there? Picking up some dirt for unknown reasons. Maybe some Japanese cherry blossoms for his wife, I'm not sure.
And he's not getting loose to Georg. He tries to get him now.
Aber ja, Georg, of course, he
Crystal's back off track.
No? Maybe run wide in or ran wide in the first corner. There's some problems for Crystal Neighborhood. Definitely. So there's something wrong, maybe with his hardware or something. You don't stop on the track if everything is all right with your car, and especially if everything is all right with your hardware setup at home. Even if the car had some issues, I think he would go into the pits and fix it and just get some more training for that car to be prepared for the real challenge. Starts next week, and here comes the move by Thomas Andrea Arisoa against Marius van Dijk, but he knows how to defend that position. Stays a bit wide, but then still staying in front. But the AMG driver for Seawolf Racing, he now wants to get back into the top 10. Especially after that spin. After a collision,
he's driving pretty aggressive for the first race, so I think he is hoping for better results in this race. So he now tries to get his plan done and get at least to the top 10 or even better.
Well, they're not racing for points here at the moment, so it's just racing, and that's probably why he's driving so aggressive. And he takes the 10th position in the Dunlop corner because of a slight mistake by Marius van Dijk. Just ran a bit too wide and then almost got into the grass. In the end, pretty easy overtake for Thomas Andy Hamiyasoa. And up in the top 10, but they are not fighting for points here in this race, of course, test race, pre-season event, and then you focus on fighting, actually, just getting a feel for the car, trying to fight the other driver for a position, figure out where you can make a move against him and where you can't, and that's something you can only do in that kind of race. If you drive too aggressive in a points race, when you crash, it's not only your points you're losing, it's the points of another driver, and that's usually worse than your own. At least I remember from my small sim racing career so far, that you're not angry about the crash when you crashed into someone. You're not disappointed because you lose your points, you're disappointed because you destroyed someone else's race. And
yeah, and Christian Neewood will not come back. He did not finish, and that's bitter, but yeah.
Oh, there's some sliding from Georg Walz, and that's maybe the chance for Nick DeWitt. No. Oh,
but he's closing it up and not letting him through.
That was a really good save by Georg Walz there. He just stood on the throttle and this somehow made it to stay on the track with that Corvette. But it shows that Nick DeWitt is increasing the pressure on the net race racing driver. But still pretty careful, I'm surprised. Nick DeWitt, no exaggerated moves, nothing. Think about, and Stefan Däniken, that's the lead driver, dropping down to fourth after obviously a huge mistake out of the 130R corner. Maybe we can look at that. Oh, that looks strange. That's almost the same we saw under braking with Oskar Koenen, if I'm not mistaken. Oh, just slightly hit the curb and then he spuns out, and he got very lucky losing no parts on the car. Usually you can quickly lose your front spoiler on a race car, and then that means we have to come into the pits. Oh, Nick DeWitt almost pushing Georg Walz into the chicane. That's a really proper fight.
Nick DeWitt is trying everything, getting rid of Georg Waltz, but he will not let him go. He tries to close every gap that is probably there and not letting him pass beside him.
I mean, I know
this leads to mistakes. If you just try to close the gaps, then you are eager to make mistakes that will maybe cost you the race.
Maybe that, or and probably even a crash with the one who's following you. But Georg Waltz, that's a very strange line. He's going through the last corner of the S's, but somehow it puts him in a good position for the Dunlop corner. And there is the spun by Nick DeWitt, pushing too hard. And he also touched the grass slightly. That sets his Corvette flying. Not much damage, I think. Some slight contact with the
opposite thing, that if you chase someone, it's you're eager to do mistakes because you're trying to push it to get beside your enemy, and so you're more eager to do mistakes than if you drive normally.
Yeah, of course, but usually the hunter is in an easier position than the hunted. It's just some mental thing. So Georg Waltz, he did just the right thing. Somehow managed to keep Nick DeWitt behind him and just letting him try and try and try. And then one of those tries failed miserably. He still has a chance to close the gap again, but I don't know if he can do it in these last few minutes of the race. Björn Wallmaier back in second after that spin of Stefan Dänicke. And Dänicke is 4 seconds behind Kostas Kaloudis, so I don't think he will get further up in the grid.
And now we see the field is a bit dragged out. There is not much of any fights. There are like 2 seconds between the nearest, and that's because of all the crashes that happened, so it's pretty dragged out.
It tends to happen, especially when you have a small field like this with 14 drivers. And
Christos just said what was going on. His printer thought it's a good time to do an update, and then he lost all controls over his car.
Oh no, I've never heard of that actually, that the printer starts an update and just sends you off your simulation. I mean, I know that can happen, that it informs you, do you want to do an update, but not that it causes the setting the simulation as a back process, but that's pretty weird, and somehow obviously he couldn't fix that. I mean, I'm commentating sim racing for quite some time now, and I've heard a lot. I mean, I know from people a lot that something broke on the hardware. That's just simple. But then I had a driver crashed into the wall because his cat ran through his pedals and he couldn't brake because he would put his foot on the cat rather than the brake pedal, and so he crashed into the wall. So pets are sometimes an issue. Sometimes there are some family troubles, like the kid just stumbled and broke his leg or something, and then you had to stop your race. But that the printer just puts you out of the race, that's a new one for me. But let's get back to racing. Still now Rob Timpen in the lead in front of Björn Wallmaier, and I think he will keep it like this, but we saw how easily you can lose your car on this track. Just touching the curb with the rear tires a little bit and then you're spinning out. And they all know about it now.
I like the livery of Rob Timpen. If you see him from behind, you think it's an all red car. If you see him from the front, it's an all black car. And if you see it from the sides, you see that it's pretty that it has three colors. I like that about his car. and about his livery.
Yeah, I think it's because of his because he's from the Netherlands, and
yes.
I think that's his flag colors he put on the car.
And there's. Thomas Andrea Mirisoa tries to get more close to Nick DeWitt, but after his spin out, he's now 1.4 behind. And I think we'll not see any attack going on in the left 3 minutes, 3.5 minutes.
And Christoph Neuwood just said in the chat that so sorry for the other drivers who were around me. I think he especially means Thomas Andrea Mirisoa, was caught up in that spin of him in turn 9. But he's a lot faster than Nick DeWitt at the moment, closing that gap pretty quickly and might have chance to take ninth position in the end. He was fighting against DeWitt earlier in the race.
And my opinion on Christian Neuwood's problem is not use any printer suits that come with it. Just install the driver and it will work. So for all the drivers with an Epson printer out there, just uninstall.
Or just well, yeah, maybe you need it for scanning or something, but just keep it easy, just say automatic updates off. That's a very important thing, especially when you're sim racing, when you are constant working simulation, a constant working internet connection is the most important thing. Just switch every automatic update off you have on any program on your computer, including Windows itself, because that's something that took me out of a stream as a commentator. Just all of a sudden my entire PC restarted and said, look, I'm installing a new update. Without warning and anything, it just did a restart, and all of a sudden there was no more commentary by me. And it was one of the huge updates, and the update was finished when the race was over. So really, really don't do that. Maybe let's take a look. I wanted to take a look at the leader, where exactly he is on the track, just to see if there's one more lap. Yeah, there will be only one more lap. Only 1 minute to go, and he's just at turn 7, the Dunlop corner. So there will be no more lap. Final lap for Rob Timpen. And by now he's 3.5 seconds in front of Björn Wahlmeier, so not much going on about fighting for the lead anymore. And so I think we can switch back to that fight for ninth position with Nick DeWitt and Thomas Andrea Mirisoa.
Oh,
he was. Yeah.
He got close on like 1 second. Maybe there's one more opportunity left.
Maybe a little bit of slipstream here from Nick DeWitt already down to turn 1. But Thomas got lucky. He was he had so much action around him. So it was quite easy for me to learn that name quickly. Sometimes you have drivers that are pretty racing pretty alone, and you don't have them see them so often. And then you don't spell their name so often, and then that happens what happened to me in the beginning. But now, let's see, we can still catch Nick DeWitt and maybe make it up to ninth. I think first opportunity, or maybe first and last opportunity, will be around the 130R corner. Putting yourself in the right position out of the spoon corner and then using the slipstream to make a move. We saw him trying that in the final chicane in this race before. Is his best chances there, but still a few car lengths back, so not enough to make a move against the Corvette of Nick DeWitt. And I think the first few drivers are already
yes.
through, finished the race, so all. We will get to that. Let's just see that fight. I mean, we are not looking for race points, so we're looking for the action on the track. Of course, Rob Timpen, congratulations for the very first win in the very first race of the Winter Challenge, of the GT3 Winter Challenge, even though it's just a preseason event. And I think Nick DeWitt is safe. No more chance for Thomas Andriamiaisoa to take ninth position. And so it's Nick DeWitt in ninth. Let's just switch to through the rest of the field again. I would like to see Rob Timpen maybe. But here he is. Of course, driving slow. Congratulations to that win. He will not start from first row. He will start from third position in the second race, because that was his position in the qualifying session before. So it's Björn Wahlmeier in second. He will start from second. Third position for Kostas Kaloudis. And he made it up to third after starting from fourth. Behind them, Stefan Dänecke,
which had a very unlucky spin out, which cost him like the four places. Started from the first and got pulled on the first place and just sat down on the first place and wouldn't let go. But then there was a spin out and he got to the fourth place. And that's a bit bitter, but I think he's okay with it.
Yeah, I know it's not about points, but he learned another lesson about his McLaren, I'm sure, and something he knows how to avoid in the second race we will see soon. Just the rest of the grid, Linus Lundvall, he made a pretty good job moving up to fifth position, started from eighth. Then David Haas on sixth, seventh position for Mike Leira. Then Georg Walz, who managed to keep the eighth position, even though Nick DeWitt put a lot of pressure on him. In the end, it was Nick with the mistake, and Georg Walz kept eighth position. Nick DeWitt, we just talked about it, ninth position in front of Thomas Andriamiaisoa. Then it's 11th for Oscar Koenen, who had a very strange spin at the chicane, just locked up the rear brakes somehow. Marius van Wyk in 12th, and then sadly out of the race, Christos Nørvoet, we just talked about it. His absent printer tried to make an update during the race, and Jürgen Wahlmeier, he had a huge crash in the early stages of the race, hit the wall out of the S's, and I guess something broke on his car and he didn't find the motivation to drive into the pits and then keep on racing. Of course, we will see him in the second race, at least hopefully we'll see him in the second race. Then he will start from 10th position. So not bad situation for race number two, but of course now a 5-minute warm-up before we go into the second race. So only 13 drivers now currently on the server, and that's Christoph Neuwuth not there right now. Maybe he's doing his update now and then rejoin on the server. He still has a few minutes. While I'm wondering what's going on with Lucas, obviously checking some data at the moment. I don't know. Drivers are waiting currently. I'm curious. So I think we will take a short break as well. And then I think you almost have it. Here we go. So we will take a short break and we will be back with the start of the second race in a few moments.
Rob Timpen wins his home race. Newwood has it. Newwood is champion. Linus and Thomas, champions in teams.
We are back with
on track.
Back on track, yeah, right. Still in the last few seconds of the warm-up. We had a few drivers just trying to figure out the race start, just testing some start moves on the start-finish line. Björn Wallmeyer still going. Of course, after he dropped out of the race so early, he needs a few more laps to get back into race mode. That's always, frustrating, yeah. When you are in the race about 5 minutes and then you have a crash and you're out of race and then you're sitting there for 25 minutes. And of course, all the other drivers, when they're finished, they have a feeling for the racetrack. They have their rhythm. They now know how it works during the race. And Björn Wallmeyer, he couldn't get that experience now.
It was Jürgen Wallmeyer who dropped out. Björn Wallmeyer was second in the first race.
Oh, sorry. Then there, just cars look nearly the same. So and both of the one. Okay, sorry, Björn Wallmeyer. He doesn't need that actually. He could just make a few relaxing minutes during the warm up. But there's no relaxation in sim racing. Björn Wallmeyer maybe trying to find that last tenth of a second he would have needed to fight for the lead. But especially the start didn't work out so well in the first race, so let's see what will happen in this second run.
And now we see a new driver, Christoph Müller. He's just joined.
So now 15 drivers on the server. Good to see. Christoph Müller at 205.362. That's quite slow, but maybe his first lap on the track at all. So that might be the reason, because it's not this is not the fastest one. Still enough time during the race to cover that, because he has to start from the last position anyway. Racing for Cold Fox Racing Division. Maybe you should mention it. Cold Fox Art, or company, they delivered those very, very nice posters. That design, and they are a small company currently developing a small platformer video game. And they just had obviously a few minutes to make that very distinctive designs for our posters, for our race posters and everything. Thank you there. And now Christoph Müller can show if he's not only a good programmer and designer, but a race driver as well. Tough job now from last position. I think everyone is already in position for the start of race number two. Not much waiting. And this time I will keep my eye on the race start. There's a McLaren still waiting in the box, in the pits. I don't know which one it is.
There's not no Daneke. One in the pit.
That's strange. And we have yellow and green flags are weaving between, especially green.
And
there's almost another contact between Rob Timpen and Pian Marmaj. And Rob Timpen again with a very good start. And a really, really good start. Even moved past Stefan Denig and takes the lead after the first corner. What a start by Rob Timpen. Let's get it close between Mike Lyra and David Haas, the two white Corvettes fighting for fourth position, just sorting everything out before the S's, and not in the S's, because that would cause a traffic jam. And Rob Timpen leading the race in front of Stefan Denecke and chased by Björn Wallmeier. So different constellation in the lead after this start of race number two.
Here we see a bit of commotion going on between David Haas and Kostas. Oh God, Kostas Kaloudis. Pretty close behind.
There's Thomas Andrea Mihosa, Haris Zoa, sorry, from 7 and Christus Knight, and Nibut is there as well. So very close racing. No big crashes at the moment. Everything looks fine. And Christo Nivert trying now to make a move against Thomas André Amisoa. And then it's in front Kostas Kaloudis chasing the other white car of David Haas.
That's behind teams. Christo Nieuwood. How do you spell it? Nieuwood?
Nieuwood. I would say Nieuwood.
Who will now try to do better, but without some drivers.
Very short. That was too late on the brakes by Thomas Andrehamihai. So he's slowing down, because that was way too aggressive against Kostas Kaloudis. You call that one dive bomb? On the few car lengths behind and then tried to make the attack. And now it's Christoph Nieuwood against Kostas Kaloudis. So more close racing than in the first race. Here's some laughing in the back.
Yeah, my girlfriend started laughing in the other room. That shouldn't happen, but maybe there was something funny, and I can understand that.
Maybe our English. I don't know. maybe she heard how we tried to spell a few names, but. Back to the racing. So Linus Lundvall chasing Thomas André Amisoa, and then it's Georg Walz in the Netrace Corvette behind. So just four cars in a row in the lead with Christo Neuwied from Neuwied from 7th, and there's a mistake by David Haas, and he drops down to 7th, maybe even 8th. No.
11th. 7th. He tried getting along Kostas Kaloudis and now dropped on behind Christo Neuwied. Saw it on the scoreboard and tried to get the fight, but then he got off.
Maybe some too late braking into the hairpin. Tends to happen. Now chased by Thomas Andriamia Isoa in the AMG, in the black, yellow and blue AMG, but he is holding back. No try to make a move in that very, very first corner. We saw him trying to attack on with late braking into the final chicane, but that he didn't do that this time, because he realized that can go horribly wrong, and somehow he is giving a chance to his teammate Linus Lundvall, who is now very close to him, and he's trying to make a move in the first corner. Linus Lundvall on the inside behind David Haas, and I think Lundvall is through. Yeah, Linus Lundvall now up to 8th position, change between the teammates. And Georg Waltz just like a watcher in 10th position.
Here we see Christoph Müller chasing Nick DeWitt, which who just overtook him whilst there was a fight in front going on. And now he's trying to get back his position.
Christoph Müller, anyway, pretty good start up to 12th now, started from last position. There's a huge gap to Jürgen Wallmeier, Oskar Koenen and Marius van Wyk.
And Linus Lundvall got position.
Because of David Haas has some trouble again. As David Haas, the white and black Corvette just came back from out of the grass in turn 9. Linus Lundvall is trying to attack him, but he's on the outside line, and that's the chance for David Haas at least to keep 7th position. And here we are with Lundvall chasing David Haas. Yes. Chased by Thomas Andriamia Isoa. Georg Waltz has to let them go. Couldn't keep up. And Lundvall now on the inside into the 130R corner. That couldn't work. That can't work out. That doesn't even work with the Formula One car properly. Maybe that's the only car it might work, but it doesn't work with the GT3 car. And now the two teammates fighting over 8th position, Linus Lundvall and Thomas Andriamia Isoa. And now it's Georg Waltz with the Corvette, maybe trying to make a move. Now on the outside against Thomas Andriamia Isoa, but no, on the outside, no chance to make that attack work through the first corner. Now try to cross, crisscross, but
and let over to Kostas Kaloudis, which is pretty close to his to Mike Lyra. And Christo Neuwied directly behind him, attacking him, pretty aggressive.
Oh. Gegner corner, he tried it to look a bit on the inside, but that he didn't do it in the end. Would have been pretty dangerous. Locking up the brakes there on the left front tire a little bit by Christo Neuwied. Looks like Kostas Kaloudis and Mike Lyra, the fight for 4th position. Lyra, driver for Kart World. And Kostas Kaloudis, also one of the drivers who still has no teammate, racing for TCS Off Racing by Visker Esports. I love that team name, TCS Off Racing. So for all those that went on about technical words, TCS, of course, the traction control system. And he says TCS off, so no traction control. I would be surprised if he would turn it off on a GT3 car, because they are usually implemented. You can turn it off, but these cars are not meant to be driven without this technical help. It's the same with the ABS. You can't drive a GT3 car without ABS properly. It's very interesting. It doesn't work in a simulation, and I don't think it does work in reality, because the brake system is it relies on that electronic help of the ABS. And there's a mistake by Mike Lara. Maybe the chance for Kostas Kaloudis. Everyone has to slow down a little bit, not to crash into the car of Lyra. But in the S's, you get lucky. Even when you make a slight mistake, no one else can make a move against you. But Lyra definitely showing nerves under pressure. So maybe the Greek driver has a chance to take fourth position. And especially getting away from Christo Niewuhod. But to pick up to that ABS thing again, it's very interesting. If you turn off the ABS on a GT3 car completely, you're just locking up the brakes all the time, because those brakes are so powerful, they need that ABS. Otherwise, they are way too strong to break down the car without locking up the tires at the front. That's very interesting. I tried that a few times in several simulations. It doesn't work.
Yeah, the cars are constipated around these traction control systems. So they build the strong brakes because of they have a traction control system. If because of that, it's not supposed to be turned off, and you have to use it if you want to drive well, or if you want to drive overall.
Yeah, especially drive quickly. That's with the ABS, and there's Jürgen Ballmeier in trouble again. And that, I almost thought he would stop the car and get into the pits, but was a contact with Oskar Koenen, and they both hit the wall pretty hard. Oh, and then there was that the rear wing flying off the car of Jürgen Ballmeier. Very, very slowly moving to the pits, or maybe stopping the car, I'm not sure. But I think this race is
over for him.
Close to over for Jürgen Ballmeier. I don't understand how this could happen. They had enough room on the long straight. Maybe Ballmeier tried to cover the inside line and missed that. Oskar Koenen was already there. And Kostas Kaloudis out of the race. There must have happened something to the Greek driver. He was in fifth position. And now I see a DNF. Maybe we can just figure out what happened there. And here we have it. Yeah, there he is. Out of Spoon Corner, if I'm not mistaken. But what caused the tire loss of the car?
He got hit from the side and then lost track.
Oh, and there was the left front tire, or left front wheel that came off. So no more racing there for Kostas Kaloudis. But that looked strange, because I think there was a slight connection issue between the two of them, because the car of Christo Niewuhod just warped into the car of Kostas Kaloudis. Otherwise, they still had enough space between
the
two of them.
Maybe this was just like a connection issue from us. So it could be a connection issue between them. But it looked like he was like being pushed from the side and then lost track, or lost his grip.
Lightly touched that curb on the outside. We got a question out of the chat, and actually that's a question that came up for me as well. Nick DeWitt out of the race very early. Oh, in front, but there's the move by Christo Niewuhod against Mike Lyra. Just wanted to check there, maybe. But I think you're looking for the reason why Nick DeWitt is out of the race.
Nick DeWitt got the position and then did not finish. So I can go back to this.
To to see if there happened more, if this was the only one. One hit. And I think that was the death switch for the engine. Yeah. Oh, hitting the wall with the front. In the, that you are speeding about when you're coming into that 130R corner, you usually have to take a bit of the throttle because otherwise you're too fast. The car starts sliding over the front, a lot of understeer then, and you can't turn in. But you still, you are. He was already speeding again, and then maybe at a speed about 200, 220 at least, and then hitting the wall without much braking. I don't think that engine survived the crash, and that's why Nick DeWitt is out of the race as well. This is the fight for a second. Stefan Denecke behind Björn Wallmeier.
And now we have the did not finish for Jürgen Wallmeier confirmed.
And don't want to race further if the car is that damaged that much, and you know you will be in the pits for quite some time, and then just doing some laps, but no more fighting for positions.
And after a little flaw of the Mike Lyra, he's now on the fifth position, and Christo Niewuth is on the fourth position.
There must have been some kind of mistake for Mike Lyra, because the gap is pretty huge already between him and Christo Niewuth.
We can get into that.
There's a slight mistake by David Haas, and I think David Haas was just going off the in turn one. Maybe switch down, because David Haas already lost the position to Kostas Kaloudis. And there he is now in seventh. Linus Lundvall passed him. But Kostas Kaloudis, he's out of the race. And took that white Corvette. Now it's David Haas chasing Linus Lundvall. The Dutch driver against the Swedish driver in the AMG. And Lundvall starts chasing Mike Lyra, if I'm not mistaken. Oh no, that's the car by Christoph Müller. I think Christoph Müller Christoph Müller in 10th position. I think he's about to be lapped. Oh no. No. Looked like a McLaren in front of him. I think my eyes are deceiving me. Just let's take a look at Mike Lyra. In fifth position, because I think it won't take long until Linus Lundvall may try to make the first move. For fifth position,
oh,
a huge crash! That's Christo Niewuth, and I think Mike Lyra in front.
That's up to Christo Niewuth.
That's two different incidents. Look at that. Christo Niewuth. That's the same mistake that Kostas Kaloudis did, but Niewuth somehow avoids the accident. And then in the back, the other Corvette you see there, that's the car of David Haas. That was a completely different situation.
But he had the same mistake.
Same problem, but oh, what a crash for David Haas, and he's out of the race because you saw his left front tire or left front wheel, not only the tire, it's an entire wheel flying off. So I think David Haas is out of the race as well. It's interesting, almost everyone by now had that spin in that corner by now, and I haven't seen that in my entire sim racing commentating career, that so many drivers have so much trouble on that part of the track. Usually you have the car set up that it, especially because of the aerodynamics, you are pretty fast and usually you have a lot of grip, but losing the car on the outside curb so easily, that means usually either the cars are set up very aggressively, so very low downforce on the back, or maybe the simulation is very problematic at that situation, and causes these cars to spin very easily.
And here we see Linus Lundvall, who's chasing Mike Lyra. Now, after this crash, the whole field is is like upside down. Christian Nivud now on 7th position after his crash. And we do not see... David Haas... Oh, he's on the scoreboard.
Still repairing, I think.
Ah.
That's the car on the left in the pit. You can see there the white and black Corvette.
Ah.
So he's trying to make some repairs on the car. And Markus van Wyk is still behind him, but I think he will take 11th position soon. Linus Lundvall with a slight mistake in turn one. That happens easily in Suzuka. You just hit the brakes a bit too late and then you're going wide. But yeah, luckily they altered the gravel pits in Suzuka mainly because of Formula One. So in turn one you don't have a gravel pit anymore, it's just all asphalt, and that makes it easy for you to recover a slight mistake on that track. I remember racing Suzuka in sim racing when there was still a gravel pit. If you made a mistake in turn number one, you already knew you will lose 10 seconds because you end up in the gravel and have to make your way back on the track, and that usually means you are like limping and collecting, even though it's just virtual, a lot of gravel, and it takes a lot of time to come back on the track. Nowadays, with all the asphalt, it's just like losing 2 seconds because you're taking a wider line, and that's it. The same here with the spoon corner. There was a lot more gravel in the past.
Yeah, I would like to correct you. It's not asphalt, it should be tarmac.
Thank you.
Yeah, I learned that from Wreckfest, which is the complete opposite on sim racing.
you might wonder, but it isn't actually. The physics, the main physics based on Wreckfest is R-Factor 1, actually. They used the basics, the basic physics engine of R-Factor 1, I think, or not R-Factor 2, for Wreckfest. So it has a lot of simulation parameters, it's just a bit turned down for more fun in racing. But I think if you might mod it more to realism, you're getting kind of the real deal with Wreckfest. And I remember I bought the beta a few years ago and they already had it on a pretty realistic level. It wasn't that easy in the beginning as it is now. It was a really tough simulation style crash racer.
Yeah, I backed it like from the first beta.
Yeah.
And I had so much fun in this technical demo. It was so funny.
yeah, it was a lot of fun. And I think these guys also have a lot of fun trying to getting a better position. And Linus Lundvall, followed by his teammate Thomas Aniamioza, Risoa, still having trouble. And
here
talking about trouble.
Björn Barmai here with a slight mistake, which could cost him the second place, but he got it pretty well back on the track, and now is followed by Stefan Dänicke, which was in first place a long time in the first race.
Oh,
and now a slight mistake, and now the distance is longing up.
Yeah, there was definitely some very bad line into the chicane, so he unsettled the car. And it's difficult to get the proper line out of the chicane, and you need all that momentum out on the straight to try to make a move against the driver in front of you, and he couldn't use the slipstream of the Corvette at all. So he is behind. So now defending by Mike Lyra in the white and black Corvette on the inside, and there was a slight contact between him and Linus Lundvall. And his teammate Thomas Andre Amirai-Soa is now up in fifth, but that looked kind of weird because Linus Lundvall's car just got slowed down very heavily. It looked extremely weird. It's just not like a normal contact, but just like someone put a rope on the back of his AMG and just hold him back like a dog. So very strange.
Maybe it was his teammate attaching a rope on the car and like I want to be first.
Now it's my turn. Something like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I wonder if Thomas Andre Amirai-Soa now is really quicker than Linus Lundvall and maybe has a chance to attack Mike Lyra in the Corvette, who's doing a really good job currently in fourth position. He's driving pretty well in the first race as well. Started from sixth. Well, not so well actually. He dropped down to seventh, but this time from sixth up to fourth. So definitely a better second race for Mike Lyra, but still not sure if he will keep that fourth position in front of the two Seawolf drivers. Georg Walz, and from net race in his Corvette, is no longer to be seen. Chased by Christo Niewuth, and I think Niewuth still has a chance to catch Georg Walz, because Georg Walz, he is a good driver, but I remember him as always not being the fastest.
Christo Niewuth made a slight mistake, and now he's a bit more off than before.
Good chance for Georg Walz to maybe stay in seventh. It's interesting, I know Georg now for I think almost 10 years. Very funny guy, always fun to talk to, and he's a diehard sim racer. He loves sim racing, and he is one of those who tries everything. This guy raced everything on every track, even though you would say you would never do that in reality. I remember how he was so excited about just testing an LMP1 car in Macau. He said that's very interesting racing. Not racing, he wasn't racing it, but he was just driving it and to find out how it works on that track. And just think about that Porsche 919 hybrid racing in Macau, where you're speeding up further. You take a Mandarin corner with more than 300 kilometers an hour. That's totally insane. But that's that stuff he loves to do. And he loves endurance racing, so I'm a bit surprised he's racing in that sprint series here. And yeah,
Linus Lundvall off on the grass, on the curbs. Visiting a bit of sightseeing
in Suzuka. It's interesting because that AMG seems to be very good to control. See that Corvette, how easily they spun out. I haven't seen an AMG spin out in the entire race evening so far, and we are only 1 minute and 20 seconds down to the end of this second race. And maybe, or not maybe, that I think is the last lap, because Rob Timpen is ahead about 25 seconds to these guys. And
I see David Haas, he's back on track, and he's like 2 minutes off, but he tries, and that's cool.
Yeah, still trying to collect some slight experience, especially finding out that Chevrolet Corvette obviously seems not that easy to be controlled. And here we are with the fight for second position. In the last lap of the race, Stefan Denecke, the pole sitter, the one who had the lead in race number one for a long time until he had a huge spin. And now he's behind Björn Wallmeyer, at least trying to take a second position. I have to say, Rob Timpen, he set a mark in this evening. Got some really, really good racing. And I think Awesome Racing, that's the name. They can look forward for pretty good results. Christoph Niewood in 8th, that's his teammate. He also did a pretty good job, just had a few mistakes too much. And especially had that hardware problem in the first race. And he's still chasing Georg Walz. And that's a fight that's also not over now. I think Rob Timpen is over the line by now. Must have taken his victory, nearly.
Nearly, yeah. He has one lap left, I think.
Yeah, so there will be one more lap. But I missed that. I looked on the timetable, but I missed that. It's still a minute more to go. So this will be the last lap as well for Christo Niewood and Georg Walz. Niewood chasing the Seawolf Racing driver in his yellow, blue, black Corvette.
We can see Linus Lundberg. We have an off track by Stefan Daneke.
Oh, and that's almost the contact between Daneke and Wallmeier. And Daneke loses the car, and this could maybe end up in another not podium, or well, the gap was huge enough. A lot of luck for Daneke. So that's the off track. Been the off track for Stefan Daneke, and that's been the end of the battle for second position. A calming end of this race for Björn Wallmeier. So this is the final battle on the track. Christo Niewood against Georg Walz. And I think Niewood is the faster driver, but Georg Walz is the one who kept a few drivers behind him, sending them into a mistake. Let's see how that works out in the hairpin. Walz stays in 7th. But there's still the 130R corner to come up. This is the full speed section. That's the 200R. That's the name of that corner because of its radius. And then the spoon corner. That's a double left-hander. Can you say it like this?
Yeah, I think you can.
And now the slipstream for Christo Niewood behind Georg Walz. But I think the gap is too wide between the two of them.
Now the first drivers are going into finish and...
Yeah.
I think this is over for now. Except if Georg does a big mistake now, but I don't think so.
No big mistake by Georg Walz, and so I think this battle is through as well. So, winner of race number 2 is Rob Timpen, so a double victory.
But what's going on with Oskar Koenen? Why has he 31 minutes 23?
Just check, maybe it's a disconnect or something? Might be.
Yeah,
maybe our time lock just has some issues. So seeing Marius van Wijk finishing his race in 11th position. And David Haas, he's already through, if I'm not mistaken. After a long repair stop, he still kept on driving. So that's pretty cool, I have to say. I always respect drivers that even though there's not much to do anymore, they still say, I am going to finish the race. That's something I remember from Formula One. That's how Sebastian Vettel got at least a bit of respect from me. because they said, you have to bring on in the car because you can't get any points anymore. And they said, come on, before you damage the car, bring it in. And he just said, no way, I will finish this race. I think that's where you can see the real race driver. If you start a race, you finish it.
The famous move of Michael Schumacher, whom has finished a race with only 3 tires left.
Yeah, things like that. Not stopping if you don't have to. I'll just get through the Grid in the end. So Rob Timpen wins the second race. Björn Wallmeier in second, as well as the same in the first race. But Stefan Denecke, at least in third position in the end. Kostas Kaloudis, who finished in third in the first race, was out early in the race after her big crash. Mike Lyra in fourth, fifth position for Thomas. Andre Amiaisoa, now a much better result than in the first race. Linus Lundvall, in the end, he finished in sixth. Georg Walz in seventh. Eighth position for Christo Niewuth, who I think can be quicker if there won't be a kind of mistakes, because I would consider him, of course, a driver closer to the top five. In ninth position, Christoph Müller, who had to start from the last position in the second race. Oskar Koenen in the end in 10th position, with some mistakes with the time table in the end. Marius van Wijk finishes in 11th, and David Haas in 12th after a huge crash as well. Jürgen Wallmeier, Kostas Kaloudis and Nick DeWitt out of the race very early in the first about 10 minutes. And they showed that Chevrolet Corvette is not that easy to drive.
Do we now go to the post?
Question. Yeah, I don't know. We will make some interviews now. I think we'll take a short break. And just inform you if we will have a short interview with a few drivers, or maybe with one of the admins about their coming challenge that starts on Sunday next week. We will definitely be back for another few minutes after a short break. Just stay with us. We'll be back soon. So we are back now, and we don't have that kind of interview of the race winners, but we have some of the administration of that GT3 Winter Challenge with us, and one of those who also raced and actually had a pretty good result, Björn Wallmeier. Good evening, Björn, and by the way, congratulations for a double second place, but you are mainly with us now, just presenting what a bit about the GT3 Winter Challenge. We already spoke a bit about it, what's to be expected, the system about how many races and how the qualification works. We saw that, but what else is there to expect for the drivers?
Yeah, it will be a real challenge. And yeah, we have 6 rounds with 2 races each and 30 minutes. And yeah, we're looking forward to this.
How will you handle the weather for each race?
The weather will be from Sao Paulo. Because when it's evening here, then in Sao Paulo, it's Mittag.
Ah, okay, so and you're starting from an in-game time, about noon, or around noon. So the idea behind is to get the weather from a place where it's noon in reality.
Yes.
Okay, how you came up with the idea of a winter challenge?
Yeah, we organized, we started with the Japanese GT series, and then we did the Summer Cup, and it's only 6 rounds, so short championship, and hope lots of people will participate.
Okay, maybe it's also because of the short challenge that there a lot of drivers there. Are you surprised about so many international drivers, or is that something you hoped for or you expected even a little bit?
I didn't expect it so much drivers to sign up. We have, I think, 32 entries, and some drivers I know didn't want to take part in the preseason event. They will be racing at Bathurst.
Ah, okay. Yeah, we had like half of the field there tonight, but that's something to be expected on a preseason event. But of course, it will be much more interesting in the real season, so to speak. So the next race, the first round, will be in Bathurst, Sunday, 25th of November. And of course, we will start again a few minutes before 7 p.m. German time, German winter time at this. And I think, Björn, you're also looking really forward to the GT3 Winter Challenge to start.
Yes, I'm really looking forward. I'm very excited. And let's see who will take the win in Bathurst.
Okay, Lucas, I think you also have some more to say.
I think it's a great start for a season or a challenge that we will see, and I think we have the great races before us. We saw 2 great races now, and I'm also looking forward to Bathurst, and yeah, I will be there for you to cast, and yeah.
Okay, so I would say this is it for tonight. We had some more information about the series race start or season start Sunday 25th November, next Sunday already. And now we know what we have to expect from the drivers, how these cars work, and especially which cars obviously still have some trouble. And it's actually the Corvette, which is driven by a lot of drivers. So that will be interesting in Bathurst, because you need a car that's not only fast, but that's pretty stable. And Bathurst is always there for even punishing you for the slightest mistake. So an interesting track for starting a season, then hopefully with an entire grid from about 30 drivers from 13 different countries. And we are looking forward to this for this evening, for this race. We thank you for watching. Hope you had fun, and bye bye.
Caution lights are down. George is. He might never win a Grand Prix!